الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا
The turn of the 20th century heralded a new era of domination, sequential conquest, and the ideological regimes of the Occidental colonial powers over the weak and crumbling Muslim nation. During the war between Italy and the Ottoman administration in 1911, the Italian government issued an ultimatum to the sovereign state of Libya, demanding at once for them to subscribe to a list of reforms within just 24 hours, or else they would risk being invaded by the Italian forces the very following day. Italy's plans were already drawn, leaving the Libyan population with no real option left except to surrender. An army of 300,000 soldiers had already been dispatched towards Libya. In October 1911, Libya would suffer the arrival of Admiral Luigi Farravelli's forces, following the ultimatum issued a day earlier. With the subsequent withdrawal of the Ottoman soldiers from the region, there remained no organized troops or governors to defend the honor and reclaim the rights of the Libyan people. But it is in the darkest of hours that the brightest of stars shine forth and realign the travelers upon the path to victory and success. It is often said that in history, great men and women are often remembered, but legends are never forgotten. There lies a trace of great beginnings from within the small village of Zawiyat Zanzur. Here, in the serene settings of traditional and rural Libya, was the commencement of hope and resistance. Concealed in the unfolding mind of a child by the name of Omar, the son of Mukhtar of the tribe of Menfi. Though the exact date is disputed, it is agreed that he was born around the year 1862. While on the way to perform the great pilgrimage in Mecca, Mukhtar al-Menfi died, resulting in the orphanhood of his two young sons, Muhammad and Omar. An orphan, like so many men and women of stature and greatness in history, the young child was adopted by a sheikh to whom his father had entrusted him before setting off on his final journey. Omar al-Mukhtar was very observant and dedicated to practicing the commandments of the faith. He was noted for observing his 5 daily prayers in congregation throughout his life. He was also a memorizer of the glorious Quran from a very early age.
وهو من النوع الذي تربى في البادية، حتى لهجته كانت لهجة أهل البادية، فأخذ من البادية أحسن ما فيها، عزها وكرامتها وبعدها عن الضيم وعن الهوان وحبها لمعالي الأمور، بإضافة أن الإسلام هذبه، فاجتمع له تهذيب الإسلام الرائع مع العزة البدوية والكرامة كرامة العرب، فكان شخصا موفقا للغاية وكان شخصا عزيزا للغاية رحمه الله تعالى. نشأ على حفظ كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى واحترام شعائر الإسلام وتطبيق كل ذلك بحرص عظيم والمحافظة على الصلوات الخمس جماعة وحفظ كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى وكان يتلوه كل أسبوع مرة يختم كتاب الله تعالى كل أسبوع مرة كان ينام من الليل قليلا، وكان يقول المرافق له كان لم ينم ليلة فيما أعلم، وهو مرافق له سنوات طويلة إلى الصباح أبدا، فقد كان ينام ساعتين إلى 3 ساعات، ثم يقوم قبل الفجر للتهجد ولذكر الله تعالى ولتلاوة القرآن، ثم يصلي الفجر في جماعة، وهكذا دواليه.
عمر المختار grew up under the watchful eye of his spiritual mentor, spending his prepubescent years studying under the local religious seminaries before graduating from the Southeastern University of Jarboub, following 8 years of advanced studies in the religious disciplines. As he grew in years and understanding, so too did his desire and commitment to teach and instruct others. Omar Mokhtar became an instructor specializing in teaching the Quran. His reputation at the university reached the ears of some of the prominent elders, who then appointed him to serve as a sheikh and instructor in Sudan. His appointment there would last several years. Committed to the education and enlightenment of his people, be they in Libya or in Sudan, the wise and profound teachings of Sheikh Omar al-Mokhtar enveloped both the inward realms of spiritual ascent and the outward realities resulting from war and transgression by the Italian forces. His first military engagement was in Chad, where he participated in battle against the French colonial powers in the region of Wadai. His courage and valor drew much attention and admiration from the senior fighters on the battlefield. And it was once said by Muhammad al-Mahdi, one of the leading shuyukh of the Sanusi Brotherhood, that all the Muslims needed were 10 people like Omar al-Mukhtar for victory to be attained. This high compliment contributed to Omar al-Mukhtar's appointment to the post of Sheikh in the region of Jabal al-Akhdar, a green and mountainous region buried deep within the Libyan hinterland. The tribes and people of that region were notorious for their unruly behavior, stubborn ignorance, and especially characterized by their weak adherence to religion. However, the wise and kind mannerisms and leadership of Omar al-Mukhtar were sufficient incentive to tame and cultivate virtuous traits and characteristics in this most disorderly bunch. Such was the success and accomplishment of the Sheikh that the Ottoman administration sent words of compliments and appreciation to Omar al-Mukhtar in acknowledgement of his pastoral activities. Upon his return home from his many years abroad in the religious institutions of Sudan and his military participation in the defense of Chad, Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar came to know of the Italian army's arrival in Tripoli. The tribes and clans grew desperate for help as the Italian troops began to sweep inland. The population was without help or support ever since the Ottoman administration retreated and removed its forces from the region. Furthermore, the small militia who were present and willing to fight were still without the guidance of a single commander. The situation was dire and the consequences would be severe. Despite being primarily trained at traditional seminaries and later on at university, the reluctant warrior soon emerged from within his deepest desire to defend and protect his land, its people, and most importantly, the faith. It was while on his way back home to his old mosque that Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar made the resolve to lead his people out of the tightening grip of tyranny by gathering and organizing small detachments of volunteer fighters from the indigenous tribes and clans. at a time when the Italian forces were considered by some Libyans as being almost undefeatable, Omar al-Mukhtar proved them wrong by successfully and repeatedly frustrating the colonial army's movements, operations, and strategies through ambushes, skirmishes, and by disrupting critical supply routes to their armies. The resistance effort brought forth by Omar al-Mukhtar and his fighters was able to keep the Italians wary and worried for the best part of 22 years, proving that a small group of warriors could reign supreme over the most sophisticated military outfit of his day by virtue of faith, wisdom, and courage.
قال الذين يظنون أنهم ملاقوا الله كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله والله مع الصابرين.
As the heavy burden of defeat and humiliation began to weigh heavy upon the Italian administrators in Libya, at the hands of no more than 2,000 volunteer fighters under the capable leadership and command of a teacher by training, the Italians resolved to draw up and agree a peace treaty with Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar. However, these agreements were not in good faith, and as a result, all the terms were dissolved and the contract was cancelled between the two camps shortly thereafter. Omar al-Mukhtar subsequently returned to his defense strategy by recruiting even more fighters and unifying the ranks among the several other factions in preparation of a decisive confrontation with the Italian general Rodolfo Graziani. The year was 1930. The Libyan population suffered immensely during the 22-month oppressive rule of General Rodolfo and his army. In this short period of time, many civilians were killed. On average, 30 executions were ordered on a daily basis, and women were routinely kidnapped from their tribes and brutally raped. Graziani also ordered for the gruesome murder of 15 tribal elders by having them pushed out of a flying aircraft one by one. Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar maintained a very high standard of morality and integrity. On one occasion, when his men seized prisoners from amongst the Italian troops, the lives of those soldiers were spared on the command of Omar al-Mukhtar, to which the Libyan fighters objected on the grounds that the Italians were not hesitant in killing Libyan prisoners of war. Not satisfied with mere revenge and imitation of the enemy, Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar responded to this by saying that the Italian forces were not our teachers and were not examples worthy of being followed by true Muslims. On September the 11th, 1931, the resistance was struck by a severe blow as Omar al-Mukhtar and a group of 40 fighters were subject to an ambush during an expedition. The Italians were able to surprise Omar and his fighters by intercepting intelligence about his location with the help and complicity of local collaborators and informants. Sheikh Omar al-Mukhtar was finally in the custody of the Italians. General Rudolf Graziani had his man right where he wanted him, a prized prisoner and a substantial proof that the Italian forces had finally broken the resistance movement in Libya. And as the final hour drew closer, in this, the last chapter of Umar al-Mukhtar's outstanding life, courage and dignity were in no short supply. And although his captors had been able to wrap his hands and his feet in iron chains, they were entirely defeated and overcome by the Sheikh and his noble composure and admirable spirit in the face of adversity and the imminent threat of death. He was tried and convicted over the period of 3 days, following which the death penalty was pronounced in court. At last, after more than 20 years of struggle and resistance in the name of faith and in the spirit of his people, after over 1,000 battles, confrontations, and skirmishes against an adversary whose army numbered more than 1/3 of a million, against a small militia of less than 2,000 faithful believers, finally, the hour had arrived. And there stood Sheikh Umar al-Mukhtar as the oppressor asked him whether he would like to impart any final words following the decisive verdict from the court. Sheikh Umar al-Mukhtar recited the following verse from the glorious Quran.
وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.
Sheikh Umar al-Mukhtar was brought to the gallows before his people on September the 16th, 1931. He was hung in plain sight for all to see. In the final moments of his blessed life, as he stood before the large multitude of his own people, bound by the oppressor, but forever free in spirit, Sheikh Umar al-Mukhtar continued to recite the call to prayer and uttered words of remembrance that would conclude with his recitation of the following verse from the Book of God.
Ya ayyatuha an-nafsu al-mutma'innah irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyah.
وعاش لإسلامه ولدينه ولم يعش لنفسه وتوفي شهيدا في سبيل الله تعالى نحسبه كذلك والله حسيبه. رجل عملاق صبر طويلا وجاهد كثيرا وقارع أعداء الله تعالى مقارعة الأبطال العظام كما ينبغي أن يكون المسلم عزة وكرامة ورفعة.
ناديتك روحا تراءت ضيا تعالت فضجت ملاك السماء وراح يحلق تحت الإله يطير بفردوسه حيث شاء ويلقى الأحبات في جنة يناغي بها ثلة الشهداء يقلب طرفا له في الجنان أحق رحلنا وزال العناء حقا لفحت رياح النعيم وخلفت خلفا.